questions are first in mind, we raise a question. As we come into the presence of our Lord, who is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, let us bow our head in adoration and honor of the one who is, who was, and is to come. Let's bow our heads. Holy and Almighty God, with praise and thanksgiving, we come before you. You are our God. We are your people. To you we lift our eyes. We know that everything good comes from you. You care for your creation. You give us strength. You give us hope. Hope that can be found in your word. May that word have an impact on our lives, so that it brings light on our path and we don't have to walk in darkness. We thank you that we can come together for worship, having fellowship with you and other believers. May everything we do and say glorify your name. Bless us as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing.
Other gods be. What it's saying is that when you appear before God, there, you got it? Good. What it's saying is that when you appear before God, you shall have no other gods, which is a way of acknowledging that the Lord is our King, that he is the one to whom we ought to present. And so this morning, as we come to worship him, we acknowledge no king but the Lord Jesus Christ. And because you have come to worship him for that reason, the Lord comes to meet with you. Receive his greeting. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ.
God's greeted you this morning. Let's turn to one another and greet each other with a handshake. Word of peace.
Good morning. Thank you. Good morning.
Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 147. Praise the Lord, for it is good to sing praises to our God, for it is pleasant, and a song of praise is fitting. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcasts of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of stars. he gives to all them. Sorry. He determines the number of stars. He gives to all of them their names. Great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure. The Lord lifts up the humble. He casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make melody to our God on the lyre. He covers the heavens with clouds. He prepares rain for the earth. He makes grass grow on the hills. He gives to the beasts their food, and to the young ravens that cry. His delight is not in the strength of the horse, nor his pleasure in the legs of a man. But the Lord takes pleasure in those who fear him, in those who hope in his steadfast love. Praise the Lord, O Jerusalem. Praise your God, O Zion. For he strengthens the bars of your gates. He blesses your children within you. He makes peace in your borders. He fills you with the finest of wheat. He sends out his command to the earth. His word runs swiftly. He gives snow like wool. He scatters frost like ashes. He hurls down his crystals of ice like crumbs. Who can stand before his cold? He sends out his word and melts them. He makes his wind blow and the waters flow. He declares his word to Jacob, his statutes and rules to Israel. He has not dealt thus with any other nation. They do not know his rules. Praise the Lord.
Praise thy son, the King of heaven, to his feet your tribute bring, ransom healed, restored, forgiven, evermore his praises sing. Alleluia, alleluia, praise the everlasting King. Praise him for his grace and favor to his people in distress. Praise him still the same as ever, slow to chide and swift to bless. Alleluia, alleluia, glorious in his faithfulness. Father, like he tends and spares us, well our feeble frame he knows. In his hands he gently bears us, rescues us from all our foes. Alleluia, alleluia, widely yet his mercy goes. Angels help us to adore him. You behold him face to face. Sun and moon bow down before him, dwellers all in time and space. Alleluia, alleluia, praise him thus the God of grace.
I think I have some problems.
Maybe the sound or AV guys can help us. I'll just keep playing until you get it up.
Next song. Thank you.
I once was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way. The sin that promised joy and life had led me to the grave. I had no hope that you would own a rebel to your will. And if you had not loved me first, I would refuse to still. But as I ran my hell-bound race, indifferent to the cost, you looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. And I beheld God's love displayed. You suffered in my place. You bore the wrath reserved for me. Now all I know is grace. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life. Oh, hallelujah. Lord, I would be yours alone and live so all might see the strength to follow your commands could never come from me. Oh, Father, use my ransom life in any way you choose.
Let's come to our Lord in a prayer of confession. Dear Lord, all we have is you. To you we confess that we have sinned against you. Forgive us for the things we have done and we are not in according to your will. And for the things we have left undone. We ask, Lord, that you will forgive our sins and cleanse our hearts. We remember your promise that you will forgive those who honestly seek your forgiveness. You are full of grace and compassion. Our eyes are on you, O Lord. Show us your mercy. In the name of Jesus, we pray for all who paid for all our shortcomings and washed us white as snow. Amen. David says in Psalm 103, praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. He made known his way to Moses, his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. He has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. Let's stand and sing. You are my King.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love. That you, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you. You, my King, would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you. You love, I know it's true. joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you.
Please be seated. During the children's video, an offering will be taken.
Jesus heals a man born blind. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love. He did many miracles and healed people of their sickness.
Oh, hey everyone!
One day, Jesus was walking with his disciples and he saw a man who was born blind. His disciples wondered whose fault it was that this man was blind. Jesus told them it was not because anyone sinned, but rather it was because the power of God could be shown through this man's life. Then Jesus spit on the ground and made mud. He spread the mud over the blind man's eyes and told him, "Go wash yourself in the pool of Siloam." So the man went and did as Jesus said, and he could see.
Wow!
The man's neighbors and others who knew him as a blind man wondered if this was the same man.
Is that the same guy?
No way.
They said, "No, he just looks like him."
Right.
No, it can't be.
But the blind man kept saying, "Yes, it's me." So the people asked, "Who healed you? What happened?" And the man told them all that Jesus had done for him.
Well, that's what happened.
The people asked, "Where is Jesus now?" But the man didn't know.
Come on, you.
So the people took the man to the Pharisees because it was the Sabbath, the day of rest, and they thought Jesus shouldn't have made mud and healed the man on the Sabbath. The Pharisees asked the man so many questions.
What's going on?
And he answered them, "I was blind, but now I can see." The Pharisees kept asking more questions. They even brought the man's parents in to ask them questions, but they wouldn't answer because they were afraid of the Pharisees. Finally, the man had enough and yelled,
Listen!
"Look, I told you once. Why do you want to hear it again? If this man were not from God, he couldn't have made me see." The Pharisees were so mad at the man for saying this that they threw him out of the synagogue. Jesus heard what happened.
Oh, hey there.
And he found the man and asked him, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" The man answered, "Who is he, sir? I want to believe in him." "You have seen him," Jesus said, "and he is speaking to you."
Wow!
"Yes, Lord, I believe," and he worshipped Jesus.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Good morning. I'm delighted you've come here today, and I have some exciting things to share with you today. Before I pray, firstly, Sunday school's back on. Kids are probably excited about that. They get to go down for Sunday school if they'd like, or welcome to stay up here too if you want to listen to the sermon. Yeah, as always, the council room's available too. If you don't want to send your kids down, but you don't want them to be a distraction to yourself or to anybody around you. But Friday night, youth, 7 p.m. at the church here. I'm really excited. I hope you will come, youth and families as well. There'll be a Teen Challenge graduation. So come on out and we will celebrate together. The Teen Challenge's most recent victors as they graduate from the program. There'll be some refreshments and some snacks that night. Furthermore, it's that time of year, it's come again, when the congregation participates in the sacred task of nomination. So thank you to Emily for putting together a new church directory. If you'd like to figure out how to get in contact with people from the church, these are on the back table. This might also help any members who are considering who to nominate for the position of deacon, elder. We look to fill three elder positions and one deacon at this time. And these are vital positions in the church, but our church thrives not only through the efforts of a few that serve on council and other areas, but through the collective dedication of all of its committed members. So, yeah, thank you to Emily for putting in the time and the effort to make that. And if you have any other questions about that, come and see me or one of the other council members. And I would urge you to prayerfully consider individuals within our midst to exemplify the qualities of servant-hearted leadership and of wisdom and compassion as you put forward names for that. So thank you for your attention, your willingness to be a part of our team in whatever way God is calling you as well. And without further ado, we'll pray. Blessed Redeemer, thank you, Lord, for the precious gift of salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. Indeed, you are our life and all that we have. Your unconditional love knows no bounds, and we stand in awe of your grace poured out upon us. We bring you humble adoration. In the midst of our daily lives, help us to recognize and appreciate the countless blessings you shower upon us each day. Thank you for the people that serve and protect us. Thank you for teachers, police officers, doctors, firefighters, EMS workers, tradespeople, restaurant workers, bus drivers, store clerks, deacons, elders, and pastors. Thank you, God, for the people whose names will be chosen. Show them, if it is your will, to let their names stand. And please bless and direct us and establish our council in the coming months. Establish the work of our hands according to your plans. And please let there be good order and true justice in this church and in your society and in this denomination. Guide our hearts, O Lord, to see the goodness in every aspect of our lives. May gratitude overflow from us, shaping our attitudes and actions. Examine our heart, O Lord, and if there is any way that is within us that's unclean, purify us with your holy fire. Teach us to lead with humility, love, and grace, mirroring the selflessness of Christ in all that we do. Marriage was meant to be a reprint, a replication of your love for the church, and all too often we fall short of betraying that love to a world that needs to see it. Lord, restore relationships that are broken. And lift up the lonely in our families and let us see how we can best serve one another. May parents learn how to celebrate the unique giftings and the way that you've created their children that might be different from that of a typical child or from what they see in their neighbors or what they remember from their own childhood. And may you equip them to train them up according to the will that you have for them and in the way that a child should go, Lord, so that we can again continue to be a bright shining light for the world of what you are to your church, Lord. And in times of discouragement, may we find refuge in your unfailing love. Grant us courage to turn to you, finding hope, peace, and strength in your promises. Help us to overcome fear with faith, trusting in your perfect plans for our lives. For those who have the gift of singleness amongst us, Lord, I pray you'd surround them with friendship and compassion and community. Your Holy Spirit is a blessing and a comfort. Let your presence be all that we seek, just that we would see your face, O Lord. Lord, help those who are lonely never to turn to unhealthy things that would lead them down a path that would separate them from you or this church, but keep them held tightly in your fold, O Lord. Teen Challenge and the Dream Center have indeed been a blessing to this city and to many facing homelessness, addiction, and trauma. And we're delighted to be able to give our offerings to support these ministries. And we thank you that we can come alongside them, not with just with our money, but through encouragement and through prayer. I thank you that you cancel debts and that you make us good stewards of that which you've entrusted us. May we use our time and money and energy not just to uphold these ministries, but to do all the ministries that you would call us to be a part of. And may you grow in us the desire for new ministries, Lord. I think of our library ministry, and I'm so thankful for that ministry, Lord. And I think of our backpacks ministry, and I'm so thankful for the opportunity to give not just hope, but some material things for a person to hold on to that would remind them of the hope that we've shared with them. And may those ministries grow and flourish. I think of our experienced Christianity ministry, the discipleship that's happening there, and I had asked that you would continue to just sharpen us, and may we know your word all the more. May you put a desire in our hearts to seek your word and to spend time there often, to read it with our families and to spend time in prayer and worship in our families. Endow us with wisdom and discernment and compassion as we navigate the challenges of this world, and may our lives be a testament to your glory, shining bright for all to see. Equip us, O Lord, to receive your love abundantly and to extend it generously to those around us. Give us boldness to share the good news of Christ with others, that they may too experience the joy of salvation. Lord, you know the needs of those who are sick amongst us, Lord, and we are ever reminded of those situations, and ask that you would be continually with anyone who's suffering, either silently or outwardly, Lord. And we just thank you that we can welcome Greg this morning to preach. Bless us as he comes to share his reflections on your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm glad you put it that way, his reflections, because this sermon arises a few months ago out of a book called Lex Rex, The Law and the King. It was written by Samuel Rutherford and is the foundation for modern democracy, capitalism, the freedoms that we enjoy. It was that book by Samuel Rutherford that got the ball rolling in that direction for the United States Constitution. And so I told myself I need to read that book because it's so historically important. And as I was reading through it, I came across a paragraph in it that really struck me. And I told myself someday I have to preach on that. Today is that day. Would you please stand for the reading of God's word? Matthew chapter 2, begin verses 1 and 2. It says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east, and we have come to worship him. May God bless that portion of scripture to us this morning as we worship the Lord. Please be seated. My first goal in looking at this passage of scripture is putting it into context. If you had lived at the time when this event happened, this event probably happened in 4 BC or 2 BC. One of those two. Jesus, by this time, historians say, was probably about 2 years old when this happened, and so that would put the date at 4 or 2 BC that this happened. So if you lived in that day, you would have understood, at least if you were well-read enough, not terribly well-read, but well-read enough, you would have understood the historical significance of this event and why it shook the city of Jerusalem. This passage displays for us the uniqueness of our Lord Jesus Christ from every other human being who has ever lived. And I'll show you that as we walk through it. And I really do want to walk through it with you. The first line says this, after Jesus was born. Notice it's not saying when Jesus was born. Because in Luke takes care of that. Luke says that when Jesus was born, there were shepherds out in the field keeping watch over their flocks at night, and the angel of the Lord appeared to them. When the angel of the Lord appeared to them, they were out in the wilderness. Notice it says living with the sheep, which is what shepherds do. But when shepherds do that, they never did it in December. They didn't live out in the wilderness in the wintertime with the sheep, which is why how we know for almost 100% certain Jesus was not born in November, December, January, or February. He must have been born in the springtime or in the summertime when the shepherds lived out in the fields keeping watch over their flocks at night. These magi that we're reading about appeared on the scene just before Jesus and his mother and father, were about to leave, being told by the angel to leave for Egypt. You'll notice something about it as well. It says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea. So we see that the Magi at least know something about Jesus being born in Judea. And we ask ourselves, how would they have known that? Well, the answer is that in Genesis chapter 49, I'm turning to that right now, Genesis chapter 49, Jacob, just before he dies, see over his sons. And the prophecy over his son Judah is in verses 10 to 12. That's part of it. It says this, the scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he comes to whom it belongs, and the obedience of the nations is his. He will tether his donkey to a vine, his colt to the choicest branch. He will wash his garments in wine, his robes in the blood of grapes. His eyes will be darker than wine, his teeth whiter than milk. Notice it says, the scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet until it comes to the one to whom it belongs. What it's saying is that there's a prophecy given there. The year would have been probably somewhere around 1790 or so, like something like that, BC, when that prophecy was given, recorded in Genesis, and the people would have known about that, especially the Magi would have known about that, and we'll talk about this in a second. They would have known it from their interactions with the prophet Daniel. Secondly, it says that he would be born in Bethlehem in Judea, which is a town, not a village, but a town in Judea where Jesus was to be born. And that is an answer to a prophecy by the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. It's quoted here in verse 6 in the passage. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will be the shepherd of my people, Israel. So, both of these prophecies were made before Daniel was in Babylon. But it's really interesting to note that Daniel, when he went to Babylon, probably in about 604, 603 BC, when Daniel went to Babylon, he probably took with him a copy of the book of Genesis. But because the book of Isaiah wasn't quite complete yet, or at least well distributed by that time, he wouldn't have had a copy of the book of Isaiah, which means that the Magi from the book of Genesis would have known about the Messiah being born in Judea, but they wouldn't have known which town he would have been born in because they didn't have the book of Isaiah. So when they go to the town, you see, they go to meet with Herod and they say, where is he is to be born king of the Jews? Because they don't know which town he's supposed to be in. They tell him, the Magi, and so the Magi find their way to the town of Bethlehem. Notice it says that they go to the town, it says, during the time of King Herod. Herod, this is Herod the Great, the first Herod that reigned over top of Jerusalem. Herod was a Roman installed king. The Roman government needed someone to rule that land, and Herod loved to be in control. He was a fanatic when it came to being in control, which is exactly what the Romans wanted. He was ruthless in his control. The Romans wanted that because they knew that the Jews had always been a people who didn't like foreign rulership. So they needed someone like Herod. Herod was considered notice it says, King Herod. As soon as any Jewish person read that in Matthew, the hairs on the back of their head would stand up. Because the Jews did not like Herod being over them. And the reason they didn't like that is because Herod was not 100% Jewish. Herod was half Jewish and half Edomite, which is the sons of Ishmael. See the conflict going on today? Can you see how that has been a conflict for him? Right? So he was constantly trying to hold on to his power. So as soon as Matthew writes, they went to King Herod, all the Jewish people would have felt their blood begin to boil, which is why Herod gave himself the title Herod the Great, because he was such a great king, and he kept pushing this on the Jewish people. But in the end, Herod had a fairly long reign over the Jewish people. If I remember correctly, it's 29 years, something like that, which is a long time for a king to survive in among the Jews if you're not Jewish at the time. Herod had a second wife was named Miriam. She apparently was a very beautiful woman, and Herod deeply loved her. He divorced, I think he executed his first wife so he could marry Miriam. He divorced his first wife in order to marry Miriam. But in the end, as Herod began to unfold, and he got sort of concerned that he wouldn't get to be king much longer, he had Miriam executed. He had his two sons by Miriam executed. Her brother, her grandfather, and her mother executed. Why? Because he felt that perhaps near the end of his life, he might try to overthrow him before he died. His son, Antipater, was executed by his father. And the son, just before he got executed, said, "It is better to be such a man's swine than his son." Meaning, if you were a pig within the castle, the grounds that Herod lived on, your life was probably safer than if you were his son. And that is true, actually. So you can see that when the Magi arrive, Herod is within 2 years of his death. They arrive near the end of his life, and Herod is still clinging on to being the king because his entire life is wrapped up around being this king. And here the Magi arrive near the end of his life, and the one thing that could have solidified Herod's rule over the Jewish people would have been that these Magi, powerful people, and we'll talk about that in a second, powerful people could have endorsed his position as king over the Jews. And Herod would have wanted their blessing, indeed their anointing. So who are these Magi that arrive? Who are these people? Well, if you turn in the book of Daniel in your Bible, you can see who they are. I've heard this before. Just considering the season that just went by, you might already know all this stuff. But it helps to point something out. Who were the Magi before Daniel? Well, if you look at Daniel chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. So King Nebuchadnezzar has a dream. And good on Nebuchadnezzar. He's suspicious of these Magi that he has inherited from his father and that have gone actually back from Babylon. So this is probably, you know, let's say probably the year 600 or maybe a couple of years after that. These Magi are the people all the way back to the Tower of Babel. These are the priests from Babel, from the Tower of Babel. So he inherits these people and he's suspicious of them, and rightly so. So look at what he says after he has a dream. Verse 10. The astrologers answered the king, "There is not a man on earth who can do what the king asks." The king said, "If you guys are so smart, tell me the dream and then tell me the interpretation. No king, however great and mighty, has ever asked such a thing of any magician or enchanter or astrologer. What the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods, and they do not live among men." When they said this line to Herod, they were Herod, which is something that happened all, not Herod, Nebuchadnezzar, which it happened all the time. They were, these people were power-hungry people. So when they say this, King Nebuchadnezzar says, "If you can't tell me the dream, you obviously can't tell me the interpretation of it." Daniel comes to their rescue in verse 27 of chapter 2, where they, you know, they're about to execute them all. And verse 26, the king asked Daniel, "Are you," notice what it says, "are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret it?" Daniel replied, "No wise man, enchanter, magician, or diviner can explain to the king what the mystery is asked about. But," notice what he says, "but there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in days to come. Your dream and the visions that passed through your mind as you lay on your bed were these." And Daniel goes on to explain to Nebuchadnezzar what his dream was, and then to explain to him the interpretation of the dream. Daniel amazes the king, and what it ends up doing is it ends up saving the lives of these magi, these wise men, these enchanters, these astrologers. They end up living because of what Daniel did on that occasion. But when you read that story through very carefully, if you read it very carefully and you know the history of these magi, of these seers, these enchanters, you know the religion that they belong to, you understand a fascinating dynamic that's going on. Notice that they say they cannot tell the king the dream. And then Daniel says, there is a God in heaven who can tell you the dream. So these Babylonian enchanters said that they got their power and they got their wisdom not from heaven, but by revelations of the underworld, the world in the ground, the world of the dead, the world of the mysterious. So that the enchanters say, we don't know your dream and we don't know the interpretation from the underworld. And if you look closely, what you'll see is that Daniel says there is a God in heaven. The word for heaven in Hebrew simply means the place up there. So that Daniel is presenting to them a understanding of God that the magi, these enchanters and so on, did not have. And so what it does is it causes a split among these wise men, who, whatever you want to call them, the four different names that are given there, causes a split. And the split happens very seriously when Nebuchadnezzar becomes a believer in the God of heaven. So if you still have your finger in Daniel, if you turn over to Daniel chapter 7, you remember Nebuchadnezzar becomes... It's a real disease, and it happens today. You think you're a cat. Like, it really does happen. Look it up. What is the name of the disease where someone thinks they're a cow? It starts with bovine, and then there's something else. So he thought he was a cow, and then at the end of the day, this king becomes a believer in the God of the Bible. I turned to the wrong place. Yeah, I said turn to chapter 7, and I wrote that down, but I mean chapter 4. Chapter 4, Nebuchadnezzar becomes drenched with the dew of heaven, and then he understands the God who has judged him. So if you look at verse 34, and notice the language that Nebuchadnezzar uses. Chapter 4, verse 34. It says, at the end of that time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, notice what he does. I raised my eyes toward heaven, and my sanity was restored. Then I praised the Most High and honored and glorified him who lives forever. His dominion is an eternal dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. All the peoples of the earth are regarded as nothing. He does as he pleases with the powers of heaven and the peoples of earth. No one can hold back his hand and say, why have you done this? Now, skip down to verse 37. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and exalt and glorify the King of heaven, because everything he does is right and all his ways are just, and those who walk in pride he is able to humble. So many times we focus on he's able to humble those who walk in pride. But Nebuchadnezzar's words betray the fact that he is rejecting the quote, gods of the enchanters, the magi, the seers of Babylon, and he is instead switching his allegiance to the God of Daniel, who is Lord of, you hear this phrase all the time, heaven and earth. When that happens, when Nebuchadnezzar becomes a believer in the God of the scriptures, the God of Daniel, it causes a split among the enchanters and the wise men. There is the first group, those who remain true to the Babylonian religion. These people continue their faith in without going into the details of it, this goddess called Mother Earth. Her real name was Semiramis, but she becomes Mother Earth and the Queen of Heaven, these sorts of terms, the Madonna, that's where she comes from. So they keep their allegiance to her, that revelations come to God's people from under the earth, from out of the grave. This religion is the same religion that was in not just Babylon, but it was in Assyria. The Assyrian religion is based on the same theories, and the Egyptian religion is also based on the same theories, same religion. You'll also notice that, so eventually, just to give you a bit of background for these Babylonian priests, let's just call them priests, these Babylonian priests, so in, I think it was 331 BC, a Persian leader, king, kicked these Babylonian priests out of Babylon, and they flee, actually, to a place called Pergamum. They set up headquarters there. They anoint the king of Pergamum as their leader, and they're actually the people who in 63 BC anoint Julius Caesar as divinely appointed over the Roman Republic, who changes the Roman Republic into a empire. And the first place Julius Caesar sets up a place of worship for emperor worship is in Pergamum, which is why, if you read in Revelation chapter, I believe it's chapter 2, where it talks to the church in Pergamum, it says this: "These are the words of him who has a sharp double-edged sword. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne, yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives." That is all a reference to these priests that rejected the faith of Daniel, went to Pergamum, and the Roman Empire, under Julius Caesar, set up the first throne for emperor worship, not in Rome, but in Pergamum. So these Babylonian priests begin this system of divinely appointed rulers. And as time goes by, what you'll notice is that the Roman emperors continue in that tradition, because now the Babylonian priests move from Pergamum into the city of Rome, and they keep ordaining or anointing the Roman emperors with that title. The title is the Pontifex Maximus that they anoint him with. And actually, I'll end with this. The European kings that got started, got their thrones just after 800 AD, are actually successors of that system from all the way back to Daniel. So there was a division. There was another group of priests, though, that actually converted to the faith that Daniel had, faith in the scriptures. And they followed in the line of Daniel's faith. So this would have been just about 600 BC. So that by the time these priests get to Daniel, or rather, when they get to the birth of the Messiah, there has been a long tradition of these followers of the God of the Bible waiting for the Messiah, waiting for his star to appear. And where would they have gotten that from? They would have gotten it from Numbers. So obviously, Daniel brought them the books of Moses. They would have got it from Numbers chapter 4, where Balak says that a star would arise out of this country of Israel. So I'm turning to that right now in Numbers chapter 24 and verse 17. So Balak's fourth oracle, verse 17, or sorry, Balaam's second, fourth oracle, he says in verse 17, I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel. He will crush the foreheads of Moab, the skulls of all the sons of Sheth. Edom will be conquered, Seir, his enemy, will be conquered, but Israel will grow strong. A ruler will come out of Jacob and destroy the survivors in the city. So obviously, Daniel brought to the Magi the books of Moses, and it's from there that the Magi would have understood that the Messiah, the star, would arise in Israel. What's interesting, though, is about the system that these magi brought, the system of government that they brought. So just as the magi who were loyal to Babylon anointed a certain kind of government leader, which we call totalitarianism. Where does totalitarian come from? Ism come from? It comes from the Tower of Babel and through these priests down through the ages, which is a different subject to talk about the history of that. But what I want to show is that the Magi who came to Jesus actually anointed kings as well, but they didn't anoint them as totalitarian leaders. They anointed them as what are called shepherd kings, according to the Jewish system of government. So that when they came to Herod, Herod being a totalitarian ruler, there is no way they were going to anoint him because he had no interest in being a shepherd king, which means one who cares for the people. So in a totalitarian system, the people are the servants of the king. That's how you know you have a Babylonian system. The people are the servants of the king, which is what we're used to, right? That's totalitarianism. Shepherd kings are kings who lay down their life for the people. Leaders who are servants of the people. So when you see King David anointed as the king of Israel, he is being anointed according to the tradition of Scripture. Of God's way of government. So that when Jesus says in John chapter 10, what does he say? I am the good shepherd. The shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. You see, when the Magi, who had been converted to the proper faith in God, they don't come to anoint, but when they come to see Jesus, they're acknowledging that here is the one who is the true shepherd king. He is the one who serves those who are in his kingdom. He is the one who lays down his life. If you saw Herod, he expected everybody to lay down their life for him. Doesn't sound good, does it? Good. Because the Canadian system of government, this is not in my notes, but it's a freebie. The Canadian system of government was set up by four men. They're called the Four Fathers of Confederation. And those Four Fathers of Confederation, three of them were Presbyterian. Three of them were Reformed. And they're the ones who set up the system of government that Canada has, which is why we call the Prime Minister a public servant, right? He serves. Is that what we're getting right now? You see how there's only really two choices? And you go back between the Magi system of the people exist for the king and the biblical system, which is the king for the people. He's the servant of the people, not the people his servants. So these Magi come to Jesus in the midst of Herod, a totalitarian ruler, and he says to them, to deceive them, I want to go worship him too. When you find out where he's been born, and you meet with him and you find him, you let me know. I'll go see him too. It's very interesting to note, now as we move on, notice it says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, where is the one who has, and then look at this phrase, has been born king of the Jews? Israel as a nation, when God set it up under Moses, is what we call a constitutional republic. A constitutional republic, meaning that the nation has a set of standards and rules by which it is governed. Now in Israel, what are those rules? Ten Commandments, and then the case laws are found in the three chapters in Exodus after that, but the entire system is given to Israel. Is anyone in Israel above the system? No, because the Constitution, if you want to call the Ten Commandments a Constitution, you'd be accurate. So is anyone in Israel above the Constitution? Anyone above the law? Absolutely not. That is the biblical system that God set in place in Israel. So then you see that when Samuel become the first king of Israel, when Samuel becomes king, notice that he has to be anointed as the king by Samuel. But then later on in the story, you'll see that the elders of the nation of Israel, they confirm what Samuel had done by declaring by their authority that, yes, Saul is king. And what you'll notice as well is the same thing happens with David, King David. Notice, I'm going to turn to, because you may not believe, I'm just going to prove it to you, because this is where we're going. So in 2 Samuel chapter 2 and verse 4. It says there, then the men of Judah came to Hebron, and there they anointed David king over the house of Judah. When David was told that it was the men of Jabin, oh, that goes on further. The beginning of verse 4, it says that the men of Judah came to Hebron, and there they anointed David king over the house of Judah. One was Solomon, a very powerful man. Everybody knows that. But I want you to notice something about Solomon in 1 Chronicles 2 and verse 4 as well. Sorry, I'm the 2 Chronicles. I wrote 1st, but it's got to be 2nd. 2 Chronicles chapter 2 and verse 4. Anyway, it says the same thing about Solomon having to be anointed as king, which means what? Samuel was not born a king, or not Samuel, Saul was not born a king. David was not born a king. Solomon was not born a king. All of them had to be anointed to their position once they got older by the elders of Israel, which is why, brothers and sisters, your church is governed by elders. The pastor isn't the king. The pastor is put in his position by the elders, and that's where we get that teaching from. So, if even Saul, David, and Solomon were not born kings but had to be anointed to be kings, then what you see there is a constitutional republic system. But if you look closely at our Lord Jesus Christ, I want you to see what it says about him. They ask, where is the one who has been born king of the Jews? There is no human being in the history of the world who was born a king. Not one. You say, well, how is that possible that Jesus could be born a king? It's not possible. He was born a baby. Well, turn with me to Isaiah chapter 6. I want to show you something here. Isaiah chapter 6. I'll read that to you. Just the first few lines there. And I want you to ask who this is. It says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. Now, just in that amount that I read for you, I want you to notice that there are the three primary titles that are given to God listed about this one sitting on this throne. The word Lord in verse 1 is the Hebrew word Adonai. And if you go down further, you'll see in verse 3, it says, holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Notice the word is all capitals there. That is the Hebrew name for God that is first announced in Genesis chapter 2, verse 4. It is called the Tetragrammaton. It is called the divine name. When the third commandment says, you shall not use the name of the Lord your God in vain, that's the name it's referring to. I hesitate right here to say it to you in Hebrew. It is so sacred that you do not say it without the utmost respect. So whoever this is, can we all agree, is the God of the Bible, is the God of Scripture, it is the God who created the world, it is the God of Israel. Now turn over with me to John chapter 12. John chapter 12. Halfway down the page on the right-hand side. John chapter 12, beginning at verse 38. It says, this was fulfilled to fulfill the word of Isaiah the prophet, Lord, who has believed our message and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed. That's a quote from the book of Isaiah. Verse 39, for this reason they could not believe because Isaiah says elsewhere, he has blinded their eyes and deadened their hearts so that they can neither see with their eyes nor hear, understand with their hearts, nor turn, and I would heal them. That's a quote from Isaiah chapter 6. Okay? Look at what it says in verse 41. Isaiah said this because he saw Jesus' glory and spoke about him. The only glory of God that Isaiah saw was in chapter 6. Of the throne of God himself. So that what John is saying is, Isaiah 6 is a picture of Jesus on his throne before he was ever incarnated in the womb of Mary. Who's sitting on the throne in Isaiah 6? That's what Jesus stepped down from, to be incarnate in the womb of Mary. So that when the Bible says, when the Magi, of all people who should know, when the Magi say, where is he who's been born King of the Jews? They're saying, Where is he who has been born, who has lived from eternity, who has been on a throne forever, and is now incarnate in the womb of a woman? Where is he? Born King of the Jews. And notice it says, of the Jews. That's really interesting. Because at the time that the Magi were founded, right? Well, at least they became believers. At the time that they were founded, the Jews were in slavery, or at least captive, in Babylon. And Babylon had destroyed the temple in Jerusalem. What had Nebuchadnezzar and these Magi come to realize? They'd come to realize that though they had wiped out the nation of Israel, it was wiped out not because of their power, but because of the sovereign power of God. They were but instruments in his hand. And Nebuchadnezzar came to see that. And these Magi now are saying, where is he, in other words, where is he who has been born King of the chosen people of God? That's what it's saying. That's in the language of the day. That's what's being said. Now, brothers and sisters, those Magi did not come to anoint Jesus. They had anointed probably hundreds of kings for the previous 600 years. Hundreds of them. In fact, kings, people who wanted to be a king, would pay a pile of money to get these Magi to come and anoint them king. That's where they got their money. They had an army, like we see these pictures, you know. Three kings come to see Jesus. That's not what happened. They had their own private army. And when they went to see Herod, they would have brought their army because Herod had a bad reputation. When they came to Jesus, the money to see this little baby, when they came and they brought money, let me tell you, it reflected the fact that they had been waiting as a people for 600 years for this baby to be born. And their gifts would have reflected that. Jesus didn't need their anointing. Did they? Did he? Did he need them to say, yes, we decide that you're king? No. They came to worship him. Because they understood that this baby that got born in Israel was the most important person who's ever lived in the history of the world. The one who, for the previous 4,000 years, God had been preparing the way for this child to be born. And they get to see it. And all they could do was bow down and worship this answer to prayer, to the promises of God. They're all wrapped up in that baby. Now, what does this have to do with you and me? It is everything. Brothers and sisters, sometimes, I think, we do not understand the significance of who Jesus is. There's a book wrote about 50 years ago called Your God is Too Small. I remember sharing my faith with a Jewish rabbi, and he's talking about the kind of Messiah he's waiting for, one who will make Israel the most prominent nation in the world. And I said to him, your God is too small. The Messiah you're waiting for is like tiny. No wonder you miss Jesus. Because you can't imagine the Messiah being the one who restores the Garden of Eden, the one who slays the serpent, the one who redeems prostitutes from being, having a messed up life, to seeing Jesus and becoming loyal, dedicated followers of God. I said, your God is too small. Sometimes I think that's true of you and me. That we think that Jesus is a one religious option among the 10,000 religions there are in the world. And yeah, maybe ours is a little bit higher. And, you know, we don't want to make other people feel bad. It's not true. Jesus is everything. Everything. What does it call him in Revelation? He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Apart from him, there is no king, brothers and sisters. I remember reading in this book by Samuel Rutherford that I mentioned a minute ago, all the kings of Israel had one purpose, to provide a line so that the Son of God would come and we'd say, oh yeah, that's the appointed one. That's all they were for. Nothing to boast about. And brothers and sisters, that's the place that Christ ought to have in our lives. He is the only one born the King of God's people. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Craig, for being with us this morning.
Price. Who were we bought by? By the King. And so we belong to him. And because of that, he is taking responsibility for us, to care for us. Receive his blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.
Go in peace and love them. Love one another.
Rejoice in glorious hope, for Christ shall come to gather all his saints to their eternal home. We soon shall hear the archangel's voice, the trumpet.